All right. And happy birthday again to Pastor Fu, a great pastor, a great friend, right? A great mentor. And I hope you guys came to hear a good word from him as well. Great teacher, so. All kinds of great things happening this morning, seeing some new faces. Man, I tell you what, we're reeling them in, Pastor Fu. But you know that we got, you guys got to pay the fee. New members got to, new visitors got to pay $40 at the tithe box, all right? That's all we ask. Man, I'm starting to sound like these televangelists or something. You know, make something happen for a little bit of money. We're praising our God this morning. He's coming back. Amen. He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. Oh, you know it, sing it. And every chain will break. Broken hearts declare His praise. But who can stop the Lord Almighty? Singing, our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb. The Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world, and His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before Him. Oh, 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 oh.
So open up the gates.
So open up the gates. Way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. But who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power. Fighting our battles, every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chain. But every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power. Fighting our battles, every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him, and
amen. Praise God. Boy, that 1 hour is killing me this morning. Tired, voice hurts. So I appreciate you guys being kind. God is worthy. He's worthy of all our praise. He's worthy of everything that we do. Amen. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. To live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say.
That's right.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. Live for you. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever sin. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. There is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. And I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be shaken. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. And I will put my trust in you alone. and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder,
show me.
Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. As worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For our Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, as I wanna see you. As I wanna see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, as I wanna see you. As I wanna see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power in love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, as I wanna see you. As I wanna see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, as I wanna see you. I wanna see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power in love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power in love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. As you are holy, 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 I wanna see.
you. Holy, 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 holy. You are holy, holy, holy. I wanna see you.
Last time.
And holy, 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 holy. You are holy, holy, holy. I wanna see.
Amen. So everybody that showed up on time this morning, you're doing adulting right. I appreciate that last song because it's kind of the subject. What I feel like the Lord wants us to be reminded of this morning is how holy He is. And that's a hard concept for us to try to imagine what holy is and what holy means. And can you recognize something holy? Now, I will tell you this, that men have made things holy themselves, like cathedrals. They built it and they said, this is a holy place. You walk into some places like that and you feel like, whoa, it's a holy place. Now, how many of you ever said before you went to church, you go, if I ever go to church, the roof's going to fall in on me. See, you have some concept of holiness if you say that. You have some concept of the idea of what holiness must mean if you think your presence is going to bring the roof down. So that says something about your nature if that's something you've ever thought of, because that's part of the process of understanding who God is understanding first our nature. Your nature and my nature, like I was raised by a tough Mexican father. Tough Mexican father. But my father wasn't raised tough like his father was raised. His father was raised even tougher. And when I say tough, I mean without, you know, remote controls, indoor plumbing. That's what I mean. Look, just not having those things makes life a little tougher. But we're used to being spoiled, or we're used to just having it our way. And that is a problem. So if you go all the way back to Genesis in the garden, most of us have heard the story of Adam and Eve in the garden and how the serpent came in and deceived Eve into taking a bite of the apple that the Lord said, don't eat of this tree or you'll surely die. So they ate the tree. We knew that they ate the tree. And you've seen the cartoons of them covered up in fig leaves, branches, right? But did you know that right after that, it says that the Lord took animal skins and clothed them? Did you know that? Some people didn't know that. And the idea that God would take animal skins, where'd he get the animal skins from? He killed an animal. Something had to die to cover. But see, the thing about Adam and Eve is they were trying to cover themselves. They were trying to, you know, because before they were just free, no clothes. They didn't even know they didn't have no clothes on. They didn't understand the concept of clothes. They didn't understand the concept of covering up. They didn't know all that stuff because there was none of that happening. But when sin entered the world, it opened up another set of eyes that we didn't even know we shouldn't have had. We didn't need those set of eyes opened up. Because it says when Eve looked at the tree, she said she saw that it was pleasant to eat. That was the draw, is what she saw. And that is typically the problem with us, because we want what we see without even thinking about what that's going to do for us, what kind of result we're going to get from that. So if there are mushrooms in the world that can kill you if you eat them, and there are mushrooms in the world that can get you high if you eat them, who found that out? Who discovered which was which? The person that lived and ran around in circles. You knew that was the guy, that was the right kind of mushroom to eat. If that's the kind of stuff you're after, this is the wrong kind. But somebody had to die to learn that lesson. I don't want to be the lesson for somebody else. Because I used to be the lesson. Don't be like him. Don't follow his footsteps. Don't be like him. Today I want to be the inspiration, because the Holy Spirit is looking for people to inspire other people with his presence. And going back to Adam and Eve and the garden. So God's holiness required in his presence clothes, apparently. And God allowed the human race to evolve all the way to Moses. And you can read the book of Genesis and tell it was pretty wild. But it wasn't until Moses showed up. And Moses, what he did is he came and he set a standard. He finally said, okay, you've been living crazy. And I'm not that I've let you get away with being crazy, but I've let you live crazy without telling you what is crazy. And so what God did is he said, I'm going to start telling you what is crazy and what is not crazy, where you can go and where you can't go, what you can touch and what you can't touch. Now, everybody knows what the word trespass means. To us, that means see how you can get to the other side. In the old days, when it said no trespass. Well, how come? Who are they to tell me I can't trespass? I'm going to trespass. Well, the Lord also gives us an example way back at the very beginning in Genesis when he, in Exodus, I mean, when he shows up on the mountain, he tells Moses, I'm going to show up to the people on Mount Sinai. You tell them, none of the men can sleep with their wives the night before. You tell them that they can't come within certain boundary with the mountain, but to come to the mountain, but don't come a certain distance. They put these stones around and said, don't pass these stones. God's going to show up today, and he's going to introduce himself to you in a way that you ain't never known. So all the people do what God says. They come out, because he says, tell them if they cross the boundary, they're going to die. And so God brings them out. I would say far away from the stone. As long as you see the top of the mountain, you got a good view of God when he shows up. But what God does, he shows up that day in cloud of darkness and lightning. Now, you've been in lightning storms before. You know, they'll make you come out your bed. They'll make you take off running if it's by you and you're outside. But God showed up and he just thundered and boom, roared. And it says the people were so scared, they told Moses, please ask God never to show up again. Please don't do that again. It was too much. God was trying to express himself as being too much. Over the top, too much. God is over the top, too much. Now, in this life, you've had to earn your way to certain things. Try for sports, you have to prove yourself, and it's based on your merit. It's based on your goodness. It's based on your talents. It's based on your abilities. Our whole world understands that. But God is telling us at the very beginning, your way to salvation, your way to getting to heaven has nothing to do with you, has everything to do with me and my love for you. And it's going to take a lifetime of listening to understand it. You're not going to get it all the first week, the first day. It's a lifetime of revelation, of understanding. of the pages turning, and you get more knowledge, closer to God, more understanding. And I feel like my life is 30 years. It's been so good to me. He's a good. He wants to reveal himself to you, but he has to do it through his word. And I'll show you his word in a minute, not the drowning man. But his word, when you listen with the heart and the idea that God is speaking, you hear his voice. If you listen I'm gonna judge what he's saying. Does it sound like this is something I would think he would say? Don't do that. Just take it for what it says and trust it and see what it will do for you. It will blow you away. I am 30 years, listen to me, 30 years of walking with the Lord, and it is magnificent. I'm busy. I'm going. I'm wore out right now. I'm very, very tired. I've cooked four or five times this past week for hundreds of people, and I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. God gives me these opportunities to just shine, just cooking hamburgers or doing whatever, and just express his goodness by giving stuff away, that I'm in a position that I give his blessings away, and I get to be a part of that. There's nothing like that in the world, but that's my calling. He didn't call you to be a hamburger flipper, maybe. But listen, he's calling you to something, at least an understanding of who he is. That's the first thing. He don't care about all this other stuff of doing these things if you don't know who he is. And the way you understand who he is, you look back in Genesis, you see what happened in the garden. You see that God covered them correctly. What they probably put on was poison ivy leaves. Didn't know it. That was one way to punish them. But God covered them. He had to slay an animal. So he shows us that there's something to the death. And so I've been the last few weeks, we go verse by verse, if this is your first time with us, we go verse by verse through the Bible. And we are in the book of Luke, and chapter 23, where Christ has been crucified. But here's the deal. I'm not going there because we've got him to the cross, and Jesus has been on the cross for 3 weeks now, 3 or 4 weeks that I've been teaching about him being on the cross. And I'm not ready to take him off the cross yet till Easter. Because there's so many aspects to the cross, to the death of crucifixion, why he had to die, why he's the payment plan for something. And so I just figured I would just stay here at the cross, because that's where it all happened. The cross is the center of our Christianity. The cross is the center of who we are and who we identify with. Our Creator is that cross. That cross connects us to that. The cross of Christ. He tells us. And so, the word salvation, because salvation, you need to understand that term. It means deliverance, preservation. Did I say that right? Yeah. Safety, salvation. And you can read these definitions to see what salvation is. And this is the deal, is God wants to save you. You have to be saved. Because think about it. What if God just let anybody in? What did he just let anybody in? I mean, he could just let anybody in. I mean, he does let anybody in. I mean, he does. But you know, he doesn't give me the option to understand why he don't just let everybody in. He doesn't give me the ability to question why the cross, why I got to believe this way, why I got to believe that way. But I will tell you this. I will say this. If you've ever gone to a church that said you must be baptized to be saved, is wrong. If Jesus Christ and what he did on that cross was not enough, then what is enough? Honestly, If what he went through, the whole process of him giving himself over to a body and going through what he went through as a human and to be pretty much just tortured and beaten and drained of his blood for our sins, if that was the cost for who we are as our, is in our humanity, if that's the cost, how can we add why would God add anything to that? You can't. There's nothing. There can't be many ways to heaven. There can't be. We're not given room for Buddha's ways. We're not given room for the way Muslims believe or the way Mormons believe. There's no room in our theology that God has given us, and God has given us theology in the book of Romans, in the book of Ephesians, in the book of Galatians. He gives us our theology. He helps us understand why it's the cross. He says the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. So when I preach, and then Paul says, all I preach is Christ crucified. Because what's happening is people are people, and people have this nature within them at times to just like being in leadership, like directing people, like being in positions of power, like being able to point the finger and people do what they do, especially religious orders. If you pay attention, if you were here, and a lot of you weren't, but several weeks ago or months ago, I posted a diagram of ancient cultures and the hierarchy of all those cultures. And every one of those had a king at the top or a pharaoh at the top or somebody at the top. You know who was always right below them? The priests in power. The priests always had the power underneath the power because they influenced that power everywhere else. How many of you have seen the book of Eli with Denzel Washington? They wanted the book, the Holy Bible, the only book left. They wanted it because they knew they could use the Bible to control people. Because just as much as it can save somebody, it can definitely hurt somebody in the wrong hands. The truth can be a sword and not a scalpel. When the Lord uses the word of truth, he's a surgeon. Precise with a scalpel. When a religious person comes at you with the sword, they're swinging. That's why you go to church and you feel like you got beat up. You feel like it's too much work. I got to tithe. I got to be a part of this. I got to do this. And they add. Listen, Jesus said, my burden is easy. And so Mormons believe that human beings get salvation both through the grace of God and their own actions. We don't. The grace of God leads us to actions. It doesn't demand actions from us. It inspires action through a true believer. A true Holy Spirit will feel the inspiration of the Lord's moving. It just will. Because I don't know who's saved and who's not saved. There's a lot of false people out there. Now, after I listen to him, I can say, that guy's not on the right track, at least to what I believe. So they're saying there's different ways. Even the Catholic doctrine, in order for a person to be saved, it's quite a tedious task. If you ask any Catholics, I was one too. It involves steps such as actual grace, faith, good works, baptism, participation in the sacraments, penance, indulgences, and keeping the commandments. There's a lot on you. But you got purgatory in their theology. And we don't see that in ours, unfortunately. In Romans chapter 5, Paul is writing, trying to explain to us why. Because think about me. A lot of preachers, a lot of pastors, professional pastors don't really respect me because I have no whatever on my wall. Yeah, no awards. On my wall, I didn't graduate, but from high school, and I'm proud to be a Trump. I'm Trojan University High School down the street, by the way. Anyways, but in this life, listen, with that spiritual hunger that we all find ourselves having, we have to be careful who leads us to truth, who leads us to because Ben, I've seen people have that spiritual hunger and be led to the wrong church or be led the wrong way, and then they're burned down. They don't go to church no more. How many of you have seen people go to church 5, 10 years and they don't even go no more? They don't even live that life no more. You're like, I don't know. Listen, when I got saved, my wife left me. My world turned upside down. I had every reason in the world to go back to the world. But I'd already tasted the world. And that world just, the next morning was terrible when you're in the world. But when I found Jesus and I started walking this journey out, it hadn't been an easy one, it hadn't been a smooth one, but it's been a consistent one. And in the end, that's what matters. It's that you don't quit and that you push forward wanting to know more. Because listen, in the end, it's not about you, but it's all about you. One of the things I teach us, encourage us, I don't teach us, I encourage us, is that we have to be careful that people that come in here wanting to be about them. It's our job to go find them and make it about them. Not for them to tell us it's about them. But in a church like this, we're all together. We're not going to let somebody come in here and disrupt the unity that we have. But at the same time, we're also not going to let somebody leave as a church that needs us our unity. And so we have to find balance because, listen, all I ever wanted was a church that I could have a community with. I started a church in my backyard just so I could have some people to just do life with that thinks like me, that just wants to do it simply. We're not having these wild parties. We're not having these wild things. Unless the Dallas Cowboys are playing and they're winning the Super Bowl, then we might have some. But we're not doing these wild things. All we're doing is just walking through the scriptures, allowing the Holy Spirit and the Lord to just teach us one day at a time, one day at a time. Just one day at a time. But we also have to understand how we're saved so that you can feel secure, so that you can feel at peace in what you believe. Somebody can't tell you. And I'm telling you, when I got saved, a postman saw my letter come to me from a church, and he says, "Hey, let me show you something in your Bible. Pretty interesting." And so I went and got my Bible. He pulled it out, and he said, he read Acts 2:38, where you were baptized in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. You must be baptized in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And he says, were you baptized like this? And I went, I was baptized because of my faith in Jesus Christ. I baptized you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Because of my faith in Jesus Christ, I'm baptized. Well, you weren't baptized. You're not saved. He told me that. I went, I didn't have a cell phone. I had to go look for the phone. Call my pastor up and go, "Hey man, I thought you said I was saved." I called him up and I go, "Hey, I thought you said I was saved. This guy just said I wasn't saved." So he had to bring me in, taught me the scriptures, did a Bible study with me, and just showed me. Because here's the thing. Paul the Apostle says himself going through, as he's speaking to this group over here, he's saying, "One of you saying you're baptizing to this guy, one of you guys saying you're baptizing to this guy." He said, "We're baptizing to Christ." He said, "That's why I'm glad I didn't baptize none of y'all." And if baptism is a part of salvation, why would Paul say, "I'm glad I didn't lead nobody into salvation"? The Holy Spirit gives us the insight to hear and to see what he's saying so that we can clearly understand for ourselves, man. Let me tell you something. Whether you're sprinkled or you're baptized, if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the one that died for your sins, and you recognize those things that only the Holy Spirit can reveal to you, and you're like, "Man, I feel different. There's something real happening here," right? When you got saved, was it not night and day? Not for everybody, it's crazy night and day. Sometimes it's a slowly turning the lights on. But it's a process. It's not like you get saved and like the scatterer. Some fell on the ground. The seed fell on the ground. The birds came and got it. Some fell in the thin soil. Nothing happened. Some fell in the thin soil over here, and the sun burned it up. Some fell in the good soil, but the vines choked it out. And finally, some fell in the good soil and produced 100-fold. There are some people that look saved for a little while at times, but listen, our job is not to discern who is not, but our job is to try to help disciple all we can so that none end up in the mouth of a bird, so that a seed can truly grow and flourish. Because listen, you want your life to have fruit. Look at your life right now. Look at your life and see what kind of fruit you have. Think about it. Look and see. I could probably use some changes. The battle for salvation is in your mind, honestly. It's in your thoughts. It's what you think about. It's what goes through your mind all day long. What you long for, what you hunger for, what the things that you want from this life. What do you want from this life? Bills paid? Just to be able to eat whatever you want to eat and bills paid and that's it? Hey, God will give you that. You can get that in this life, but there's so much more available to us, and it's the understanding of who God is and see him in the world today. It says, therefore, having been justified by faith, listen, that's very important. You're justified, made right, made clean, made good. That's what the word means. It means all those things. You're made right just by believing. For when we were still without strength in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. I was ungodly. I know my wife was ungodly. I'm just kidding, babe. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates. Look, you know what that means. Me and her demonstrate our love for each other in all kinds of different ways. But she recognizes my love and I recognize her love. Just while I go, I go, babe, will you go get me a water? Give me a water. To me, that's her just loving me. Just without even going, get your own water. She has said that before. Yeah, I said that before. But it's just wonderful that look, because it's a demonstration. To me, it's still a demonstration. But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still jacked up, doing bad, messing up, with no idea of God in our thoughts, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, not just his life, but his death, we shall be saved from the wrath through him. There's a wrath coming where God's going to judge. When you look around the earth and you think, man, that regime needs to be judged. That country needs to be judged. Those people need to be judged. That position needs to be judged. Listen, it's coming in God's timing. What you need to be concerned about is your judgment. And you can take care of your judgment by being justified by his blood through faith in Christ. It says, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. We finally have been brought back to God. We were created to be with him, but sin got in front of it, got in the way, because he can't come to sin. In the priest, the high priest at the Jewish religion, the high priest was the special guy who got to go behind the curtain once a year to see the ark and to offer the sacrifices. But there was a very strict stipulation on the process, the cleansing and the purification. He had to do all these things to get ready to go before God. And if he didn't do it right, they say that them guys had bells on the bottom of their robes, and they would even tie a rope around the ankle in case he wasn't pure and he had some sin in his life and he fell dead back there. If somebody tried to go get him, they'd fall dead too. So that way they could pull him out and nobody have to go in there. The Lord is trying to open up our understanding of his holiness. The Lord is trying to open us up to understand of how pure he is. And me and you, we look in the mirror. Okay, I'm as pure as I can be, I guess. That's about it. But we know. We know what goes through our thoughts. We know what goes through our minds. We know sometimes we want to slap somebody. I know you do. Sometimes you want to slap somebody. Sometimes, especially when you drive the circle. I like bringing the circle up. We should all be aware and know that we're sinners, right? I mean, right? You're aware that you're born that way, right? Because if you don't think I'm true, go sit in the toddler's class. Go sit in the toddler's class. And I guarantee you the parents did not teach them to say, mine, mine, mine. They did not teach them to say that. They have to teach them to share. So you have to instruct your kids to do the things against their nature. So how many people are in this life are running around following what they were born to do? And mad because we're not okay with what they were born to do, because we've also have had to repent of what we did when we were born the first time. But now that we're born a second time. And see, that's the thing about Christianity. It acknowledges that people are born all kind of ways. It acknowledges that people can be born thinking that they are other things. But Christ tells us we must be born again so that we can truly have our eyes opened up to see who we truly were meant to be. And that is heaven bound, heaven prepared people. Nobody will get to heaven and go, I made it. Can't believe I made it. I mean, we're probably all going to say that at the end anyways, but I guarantee you, people that don't want to go to heaven will not go to heaven. People that don't care about heaven, heaven won't care about them, unfortunately. Although God did love them enough to die for them and give them each an opportunity. Every living soul will have an opportunity. One way or another, I don't know how it works, but one way or another, we'll have an opportunity to say yes or reject truth. I live a great life. And God still has many ways of expressing his love to me. And this morning, I have two old friends, long-time friends. The interesting thing is last week my friend was here that led me to church. Showed up, visited me. First time ever visited me in church, even though it's not theirs. But when Patricia and I first were married, I told her, I go, I just want you to know that I'm called. On our first date, I told the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm going to have this first date with her. I'm just going to tell her that I'm called. I don't know what that means, that I'm all about you. And Lord, if she tries to change the subject. But I also prayed, Lord, please don't let her say bye-bye. Because she was 21. She had a job. She had a car. She was independent. And of course, beautiful. And I was 29. And we went on that date, and I just told her my testimony, just told her how I felt like God had called me to ministry. I don't know what that means, where that's going to go, maybe mission, I'm not sure. And so she started asking me questions about it, and asked me questions, and just engaged me with curiosity. And so it just began a journey for us, and That was in 94. And then in 99, the opportunity came to go pastor a church in Port Aransas, Texas. I got a phone call, said there was a church that pastor had left and they were looking for a pastor. There was a few people left. And in Port Aransas, you know, it's not like Waco. When I got saved, I thought I was just, you know, I had long, beautiful hair. And I thought I was going to be a thug preacher. I thought I was just street preacher to just would do the street ministries. And that's what I thought. I just it made sense to me because that's who I was. But when I went to Port Aransas, there ain't no Mexicans living there. There's no thugs hanging out in Port Aransas. There's just white people from up north. They all come there in the winter, Texans. And it was just weird that my church had nothing but white hair, blue hair, and people from Minnesota, Michigan, and New York, and all these places were coming to this church, and I'm from South Waco. You know, and I've never preached before in my life. I've never taught before in my life. I never went to school to how to do that. I would even flip in the mornings and go, what am I going to preach today? Let me look for the word love. And I just looked for the word love, and I just knew I couldn't go wrong with love. And so I'd always preach just in anyways. But getting there, my self-esteem was just kind of all over the place. I didn't know. And my friends, Chris and Gary Lubitz, were in that church. And the very beginning, you know, 20-something years ago. And just spoke life to me. She was good with her words, and she just knew how to write them or just say them, and she would encourage me. She'd write me these things, and I felt like I was a pastor. I mean, I didn't, anyways. And she came to visit me today on my birthday, her and Gary, and what a demonstration of God's love and just continuing watching me. And I always feel like he's watching me through your eyes and that you're listening to me because you listen to me on Facebook and you respond. You let me know you're listening. And I feel encouraged and I sense his presence. And you know, we're all in a place where we can experience so much. Just love and just, I mean, going to heaven is great. I mean, it's the greatest thing, but I've never been there. This is where I'm at. This is where I'm stuck right now. And because I'm stuck here, I want to make the best. And I want to experience life with you guys, just like I had with Gary and Chris over the years. And thank you for coming and for speaking into my life all these years. And listen, Christ loves you. The Lord loves you. And stay on the journey. Just stay on the journey. Just don't have too big expectations other than God's going to do more than you imagine. Just have that expectation because he says he's able and willing to give us above and beyond anything we can hope or imagine. He says that to us. So just one day at a time. Just look at life and go, can I see God in here? And if you can, praise God. If you can't, ask yourself why. And then if you need to know more, then you can come ask me. I'll help you. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for taking the words that seem to be all over the place this morning and put them in the right place in certain hearts this morning. I trust you're speaking to people this morning, Lord. Lord, I just thank you. I thank you that you're real. I thank you that you've proven yourself in my life a million times. I thank you that your miracles are solidified, Lord, in my memories. All your workings, all the good things you've done in my life, Lord God, they just so outweigh the trouble that I've had. And Lord, I'm thankful that I can be a witness and a testimony to those around me. And I pray for those that are having a hard time right now, Lord God, that their eyes on the world would shut down and the eyes of the Spirit would begin to come into focus. That's the only way to have peace in this life. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Everybody just hang on a second before you leave.
Cake's coming.
Hang on just a second.
We got a cake coming. David, you got here just in time. That's all right. You got here just in time for the